So, Thomas.
Hi.
It's been a while I haven't seen you. Just to let you know, we've worked a few times together on very large scale projects, mostly outdoor, and one maybe more intimate in Académie Conti, where the installation was very pure and reminds me
in a way
a little bit of this installation. I was thinking of going back in history, but I think the exhibition is so strong that we should really start with the exhibition here. Okay. I've been really struck by the way the sculpture cut through space, in a way.
Yeah.
And even the smaller the scale upstairs, the more the place they take in space is clear.
Yeah.
You know, or they cut into the space and make the... They really do something to the air around them.
As I was telling you earlier, the studio... I mean, I've been going through a lot of changes. And I think always with an artist... It's really strange. I once read this story, and it's a silly story, but it's kind of a good story, which Anthony Caro was at St. Martin's. I was at St. Martin's, but years before, when it was happening in the 60s, and he was taught by Henry Moore, right? And these are two sculptures I'm ambivalent about, but I love the story. And Anthony Caro was making these pieces that look kind of like Henry Moore's, and he was unhappy. They looked like kind of 50s British, and... he said to Henry Moore, how do I change? I don't feel like I'm making work that I should. And Henry Moore said, you have to change your routine, you have to change what you eat, you have to change when you sleep, and you have to change the way you deal with the world on very basic levels. And it always resonated with me because, you know, the idea of change in art is like this modernist, you know.
The idea of breaking through.
Eureka, right? And I think that actually change comes from very slow interior work. And I think, you know, your comment about the space, it's the studio right now in Los Angeles has kind of split into these zones. I was telling you, a zone where the sculpture really interacts with the world very directly and with people scale, a one-to-one almost scale, not unlike the Moonroom or the Rockefeller masks. But this kind of taken more and more deliberately, that sculpture has this role socially. Then there's an area of the studio that's very, very intimate. You talked about the wildness, and I think I grew up conditioned towards wildness, towards an anarchy, towards a real discomfort with the world. And so in a way, the 2D painting, I call it painting, but I'm not... really paint, it's kind of drawing and mapping and now using color to kind of, I realize color has an emotional space component, Mondrian would have told me, but that's where that wildness happens in some ways. And it's a much more intellectual wildness that's starting to happen. And then this started growing with this sculpture practice that was really intimate and small. And so the sense of scale that these works, I agree with you, I went small and suddenly I can imagine them, you know, 60 feet tall. And we just noticed as we installed them here, how much space they take. So, I mean, me and Xavier were joking, you know, Xavier for years, I mean, 15 years, has been saying, you know, all the great sculptors could make small stuff. And, the typical Zami, you know, it's like, are you saying I'm not a great sculptor? And he's right. He's totally right. He was the first person to kind of dare to say that because we've known each other so long. It's an idea of intimacy. It's an idea of relationship to the body that's different. And I couldn't do it. And Mona can just watch me for 5 years in a really concentrated way, be like, I want to make small work that has meaning. And I couldn't. The energy that I was living in my body negated that. I was constantly in a battle with something bigger than me. I was like a child in the studio with this... a
figure larger than life.
Yeah, this monstrous struggle. And I think, you know, I did somatic therapy, which I don't know how popular it is in Europe, but it was a massive moment for me.
I was thinking about the work before talking to you, and I thought you really have artists that close down the world, you know, they can only work in a studio without window where the outside is excluded, and it affects the work.
Yeah.
And some other artists are connected to the world, and I can definitely feel here, you know, in the work, this connection to the outside, like, like those works are not closed down on themselves.
Yeah,
the outside. But I came to that thinking about the British modern art. You know, there is a show in London now called All Too Human at the Tate Britain. So they address this obsession of British modernism with the human figure.
Mm-hmm.
Like almost no important British artist of the 20th century has ever...
Hockney, Bacon,
Bacon, Freud, Henry Moore.
Tracy Emin, Henry Moore.
I mean, of course you talk about Caro and he broke away, but it's a few examples. And I thought, oh, in a way, you never broke away from the human figure.
No.
Either, but I feel it's for different reasons.
It is.
So that's what I wanted a little bit to explore.
That's a great question, Anne, and it's that's the center, really. We're right at the center of the thing, and I think the English obsession with the body is a really interesting thing, and it's even in Shakespeare. I mean, and it's even in the writing in England, and it's in life in England. England's a very physical culture. People forget that. You know, London is very elegant, but it's physical in a different way. It's remove.
Yes.
Right? It's removal of touch. The North, where I'm from, is all about touch as violence, confrontation, but also inner violent energy, which can be both really exciting, thrilling, and really frightening. And for me, I came from that northern background. And your question is super pertinent because recently in Los Angeles, I befriended and got close to David Hockney, right?
Uh-huh.
And we're both from basically Leeds. He's from Bradford, I'm from Leeds. It's like the same town. He moved to LA for certain reasons, and I moved to LA. And I was nervous about meeting him, and I was nervous about dealing with him. And finally, I mean, in many ways, Mona like forced me to go and see him and pay my respects. And I did. And it was this incredibly powerful experience.
Mm.
And I realized that his way of dealing with the body, I suddenly saw it through a new light, that we were both products of highly charged relationship to humans, right?
Mm-hmm.
And there's a kind of tension in David Hockney's figures, both sexual and political and class-based, you know, the collectors, all this. Now, I suddenly kind of got, I think I felt it in my stomach, but I got. And there's a kind of violence in certain British artists, Bacon, Freud.
But very existential.
Very existential, but it's also about the difficulty of dealing with what it means to look at somebody and be in relationship to somebody.
It's very dark.
Very dark. And my experience up until recently, and you've known me long enough to know this, was that I came from this hyper-violent, hyper-traumatized model where I was really making art to survive. I think why I never fit with the YBA, the Young British Artists, it was much more intellectual, it was much more theatrical, and it was much more socially based, dynamically. For me, I was in this very brutal, very personal...
First degree
difficulty with being in my own body, being in relationship to other bodies, being in a state of fear most of the time. And so I'd used alcohol and drugs all my life to kind of mediate this, but then of course you're in some ways more crazy and all this. And so the work that I did up until recently, really recently, I would even say like 2 years ago, 3 years, and in fact your show, funny enough, it's funny you mention it, was the first time I began to slow down, like with the egg.
Yes.
In relation to, we start to like pull apart something about looking and being in relation. And that's been a really couple of year journey.
I think for me the Houseago show in London was opposite. It was so populated that it was very difficult to engage with.
And I really wasn't, and I'm going to really, this is an odd thing to say, but the house of show in Silver Run really wasn't making art per se. You know, people always talk about, like, I don't want to make art, the conceptual. Well, I really wasn't making art. I mean, I was just in relation to trauma, to discomfort. So
it was the first time you came back to the UK as well. Yeah, so that was.
And so I was, now I can look at that show. I mean, it always surprised me when I walked into the show with my mom, who I have a very difficult relationship always. My mom burst out crying. She never cries. She's like the sternest, toughest, and just like cried, like floods of tears. And I was like, what's wrong with you? You know, I was very armored. I was like, this is my fucking work. Like, don't cry. How dare you cry? You know, like, and my mom cried in a way it was shame also. And I was always like, what's that? And I saw people's reaction to that show in England. They were like, what are you doing to us? Like, you left Leeds, you went to America, like, we avoided you, now we can't avoid you because you went to fucking America and you're coming back like famous, so we have to give you some room. But they were horrified. And they had good reason to be horrified because the show was horrifying. I mean, if I look at it now through the lens of where I sit today, it is horrifying. But it was horrifying in a way that gave nobody space. It's like somebody screaming, as opposed to somebody speaking quietly about something. And so it screams at you, it's like, oh, and that's a kind of adrenaline relationship. But I remember that show really troubled you.
Yeah, no, no.
And I remember Mary
Moore, complicated.
Henry Moore's daughter, came to me at the opening and she said, I'm worried you're gonna die. Mm. I was like, what are you talking about? I'm doing fine. Right? But I was living in death because, you know, Michael Stanley, 1 week after my show opened, we did a talk at the ICA together, and he killed himself.
I hope it.
It was like, yeah, no, and you're fine, you're in the new phase. Only blessings are
dangerous.
Yeah, at night, just be careful. But it was, it was a time of death, and I was going into a time of death, and I'd gotten really close to there being no distinction between my inner kind of turmoil and the work, and it was solipsistic. I think that's what you're saying. It was me and the studio. I didn't care what people think. I didn't care if it sold or not. I didn't care if it was good or bad. I didn't care if critics liked it or not. It didn't matter to me. It was this activity that was somatic, that was in my body. And I think the journey that this show, and I really wanted to show this whole body of work with Xavier for a reason, because he is the person I've worked with the longest, and he's the person in many ways I've had the most intimate discussions about my life and my journey. And, you know, I think we both felt that the work, you know, I think me and Mona really felt that this body of work was very fragile. You know, you come to the studio and there's this giant project I'm working on for LACMA, and there's this other giant project, and then somewhere in the back, there's this group of work, and it was coming like a little forest, you know? And I was doing this somatic therapy, and I was working on those pieces straight afterwards. It was a place for me to start processing the energy from my body differently. It was like a very crucial distinction, you're right, about scale. Number one, I was becoming an adult in relation to my own work. So my scale, I became big and the work became small. I began to think about, like, I suddenly thought, man, how nice would it be to make a sculpture that somebody has on the table and they can look at and feel those things still, but in a totally different, in an everyday life. I was thinking a lot, I listen to music all the time, like all the time. And I listen to music domestically, you know? It's like, and I thought about that. I thought about
it's music. Not always a symphonic orchestra in your kitchen.
And the idea of almost like a sculpture you could have in your pocket, you know? I thought, wow, that would be great.
Well, like African sculpture have that.
Yeah, or if you think of cycladic art. I mean, in a lot of ancient art, sculpture particularly, there was this idea of it being part of the body, being in a pocket. So I'm really moved that you feel the difference. I wasn't sure
I think everyone, work. I mean, from what I saw, the few people who saw the show...
There was an idea again of these themes that had been bothering me and upsetting me, you know, the face as it becomes almost like a skull, or as it becomes almost like it falls apart. And how when you look at a face and you're in a certain headspace, the face becomes really almost like a Giacometti, becomes a very mannerist figure, because as soon as you understand there's a skull behind the stuff, everything becomes this kind of architecture of the face. Then the owl, which is the emblem of Leeds. So I hadn't realized this, but me and Mona took a couple of very intense trips to Leeds. I tend to avoid it because for me it represents so much. But there's owls everywhere in Leeds. It's like I didn't even realize it till now that the owl is this image of Leeds. It's, I think, the owl and the unicorn, or the lion and the owl. And I realized that this owl image had gone into me. Mm. And had become. So I took this striding figure too, a very, very important like theme for me, the walking man. I mean, now I look at my older work, really within 6 months, I suddenly look at my old work, and I'm working on this show in Paris, right, which is a kind of retro, mini, mid-career retro. So I'm really looking at work from the 90s and when I was really... And I can already look at it with a kind of empathy. I can look at the Savile Row show with a kind of empathy.
I think there is a common thread for me from all those periods and today is a very strong vitality.
Yeah.
You know, there is always, I mean, that's why I connected to the work. I like works that are connected to life and that carry this intensity of life, the flux, you know. And it's always there. It was there with the anger, and it's now also in this space. You haven't left that dimension.
I think it's really, I mean.
And that's what I feel is very un-British, because I find the British art is sometimes a little bit bloodless.
Exactly.
To be aliveless. I'm sorry to say.
No, but you know,
you make a lot of
enemies. You always said something that really struck me.
And I feel that, you know, you have this incredible vitality, and that's something that pushed you away from the UK.
For sure. You're 100% right. I literally could not exist in the UK. Mm. And this is not an intellectual thing. Literally, I couldn't. And it was a very uncanny feeling because, I don't know if you ever saw that Bob Dylan documentary Martin Scorsese did, where he said, I was born in the wrong place, I was born to the wrong family. It's like, come on, Bob. But, and in a way, Bob was hipping Minnesota, you know, to write, you know, these songs is odd. I just said, no way. But for me, growing up in Leeds, my natural characteristic. Well, there is a quality in this that's hyper vital.
Mm.
I mean,
that you don't know in London.
Fucking like, really, you know. And there was, my childhood was life, death. You know, when I was already really a baby, I was already dealing with death. It was like right there. I never had the baby gag out. Like, woo, the world's beautiful. It was like, But also in Leeds, there was something I really related to. But it was usually in the people who were going to end up in jail or in the military, or there was this kind of with the world, you know.
Yeah.
Space is too small, you know, rooms are too, schools too small. And I had that, but it was like weird because I didn't want to go to jail and I didn't want to die. I also didn't, I wasn't good at anything else. I mean, school for me was like, you know, I just couldn't understand what they were talking about. At all. Not in a rock and roll way, but like it was like living behind glass. It was like, oh, you guys are doing this stuff. I had no access. And I art came to me through performance.
Mm.
And by chance in Leeds, I met this tutor. Like, there was a lot of radical people in Leeds who was like, you should look at Joseph Boyce, you know. And then I saw Thinking Becomes Form and all these ideas in social sculpture. But I couldn't fit in. I was, my gods were never British. I never cared about that. I never cared about it. So when I went to London, I literally could see there was no space for me. I had no right being there. So as soon as I could, I left, really. But I think for me, I felt it was very important because I had access to it, that I managed to maintain this relationship to my body as a body. Yes, as a body that went through certain things, But you don't have to have gone through what I've gone through to have access to my readings of how a body operates in the world. And mine's not truth. I don't say my work is like a truth or is the right way or any of this. But I understood that that space, which is sometimes hard to get into. It's a weird thing. Sometimes it's not there for me at all for a while. But when it's there, when the studio, when I feel that openness and I feel that porosity and I feel I have access to myself and to the material, to really allow that to flow and then edit afterwards, then say, whoa, you know, what the fuck is going on? Because it's not a stream of consciousness, it's more like performance. And sculpture has a relationship to dance and performance. It's closer to dance and performance than it is to painting in some ways.
It's true, it exists in the space in a way more closely than
And materials exist in the space.
But in this little Me Too moment question, about your, because in a way your figure, they are not male or female. Or
no.
I've noticed that today.
Always.
There is no, they are not gendered.
I'm not trying to make reality. I actually think reality can be kind of an enemy sometimes, you know, right? As soon as you get, in my case, into too much specifics about who and what, is it that, am I representing that, and this. For me, the third space, the art in a way is a Frankenstein, you know? It's not reality and it's not a fantasy. We were just in Scandinavia and I was looking at monks' paintings. In Scandinavia, which is really it's like saying Goya in Spain. And Monk understood reality, really got it. Just like Picasso understood reality, just like, you know. But he was able, he did this strange thing, and I really felt it at this phase in my life, that he took reality and he kind of drained it. He kind of, not drained it, but he kind of, what do you call it when you condense? He filtered it. He filtered it, and he filtered it, and he filtered it, and he filtered it to get to a kind of third zone. I mean, you would never believe that Munch's spaces and Munch's depictions are real.
No.
The screen is not real, per se,
but
it's
it
super
is.
Real.
Yes, of course.
It's a third reality.
It's more real than real. It's the idea of art. I mean, I think for myself, if you look at a Titian portrait, the person is more real and alive than any real person in the world.
Exactly. And if you walk through academic art, if you walk through any museum where you have rooms of academic, you can kind of, it's all really real. I mean, they really care about getting how it looks and da-da-da, being truthful to reality, which is kind of honorable in a way. But you really, the work that shocks you when you walk through any museum or even when you listen to music is the work that like creates this fantastic space where it doesn't matter really if you've lived in Norway in the 19th century or you've lived with Van Gogh in art, but you feel an understanding that there's a space for you to feel your senses and to feel it in your body.
Yeah, the experiences.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah, you feel it in music all the time. We're much more comfortable with music, with how it, you know, with how it impacts us and with what it does. But art, that's...
Well, I feel it's a dimension, this connection you're talking about, is difficult for the viewers today. I think more and more difficult, because maybe there's so many saturation, but also when we go somewhere, we have a lot of explanations and things. And I've seen people address the work more and more intellectually with information, you know.
Yeah.
You go to a show and it's all about the information.
Yeah.
So that connection to what the work does, this condensation of this experience, you really have to also take away layers of knowledge and of yourself in order to be moved
to
or
be
touched.
Or to access. And I think, you know, I've always, when people say, I don't like your work, I'm always completely comfortable with it. To me, that makes sense. If someone comes to me and says, look, I've been looking at work, I don't like it. I always see that as a kind of form of praise. I always think that they're telling me, hey, I've noticed you, That's what I hear. I mean, sometimes it hurts me. I feel like I'm vain like everybody else. But I'm also struck always that I don't always like my work. I mean, it drives me crazy. I don't live with my own work. I will not have it in the house.
Many artists.
I can't live with it at all. And I also make work that... I mean, we live in this period where you have the auctions and you have the market and you have all this stuff, which urges... And we have the internet, we have Instagram, which urges these very easy readings of art. If it's a good investment, yes, great. If it feels seductive, great. We're in a very weirdly seductive, strange period.
On that level.
On that level. But also...
Not institutionally, you know, it's very different layers.
You have these very big, and you really have these marked things. And I feel it's important that my work, I'm in a, let's say, old European notion, or it's very romantic, that the work doesn't necessarily have to immediately please people, connect to people, or make them happy, or... You know, some of my best work, I completely rejected at the time. It was too horrifying. Mm. I was saying something about my experiences, which were horrifying. I lived through horrifying things, and I made work about that. And I made work about that with no filter. I mean, it was literally, I was reenacting in the art, somatically, the experience. And I look at them then as like, what have I done? And I look at them now, I can't believe I did that a bit. But I also am glad, because my idea of art shouldn't be that it eases into society in a decorative way. I don't think it should. I think it's important that art's making comfortable art. That's why I love my guy. I know you do too. It's uncomfortable.
It's very uncomfortable.
It's very uncomfortable. And that he got.
When I prepared a bit the talk, an idea just popped in my head. It's this... Nietzsche divided the world between, you know, Apollonian and Dionysiac.
Yeah.
And I thought, oh, you know, your work is so Dionysiac. Yeah. And it's funny you talk about the history of art when you move and you see all the works that try to mimic reality is not the one that struck you. You know, this kind of this cultural balance of the Greeks. I mean, I really don't think you're in a Greek ideal. No. You have the Cycladic, you have moments of the Greek art. But the classic, you know, this idea of perfection and balance and is really something you away from. So I was thinking it's really on the Dionysus part, which is about the life and the celebration, and Apollonian was all about restraint and balance and control.
Exactly, and being measured. Using
which Nietzsche was anti-life, you know, when it was the negation of life.
And well, the problem was that...
He thought this Christian value and the Greek idea was...
The 20th century was so traumatic because the acting out that happened in the 20th century, the Holocaust, the wars, the violence, got put in the Dionysian kind of category for somehow, intellectually, And that's actually not true. I mean, it's human nature, I think, is at its safest when it's able to express. When we have room to deal with really our feelings, you know? I mean, and really be okay not having to act on them. I think we're our most dangerous when we repress. White men need to be in the business of being, in a weird way, Dionysian, but with the idea that comes, which is healing. A Dionysian thing for me is about healing. Mm. It's like the acid trip, right? You go on this journey, you know? You discover the sky and, you know, your feet on the ground. That to me is very important now because, you know, you're right, what's happening with the body and the iPhone is strange. What's happening with the way we receive images is strange. And it all plays into this much more classical remove. I can't tell you how many people will say, oh yeah, I saw your show, it was great. Really? When did you?
On Instagram.
No, I saw on Instagram. It was excellent. I'm like, I'm a sculptor, motherfucker. Imagine if I said to a friend in a band, yeah, I saw your show, it was epic.
But it, you
on
know,
TV.
A friend of mine sent me 3 photographs of sculpture that are upstairs.
Yeah.
And I said, oh, I like the second one best. And then I arrived here, and no, it was not the one I liked best because the experience you have in person.
You have to have. And it's funny, David Hockney, he's like, photographs have failed. That's his, he's 80 something years old. He's used photography. And he said, it's a very Yorkshire, no, photographs have failed, they're a failure. It's like, David, you've used them all your life, no, but they've failed. I can, you know, announcement, photography's
failed. That's a good, that's
and
a good point.
Right, in a way, he's right. In a way, he's right. And as artists, I think we have to constantly fight for different spaces, you know. I think it's really, in the Me Too thing, it's really important to fight for these changes, and it's really important to fight for gender equality and racial equality. So important that art is often a leader in these things. But art also has the right to kind of also make these other spaces that actually create richer discussions. You know, we got to be careful that art discussions are we have to remember we're in a body, we have to remember that we have actions, that we will end this talk today, and then there's endless opportunity for actions throughout the day and reactions that you're having to things. And you have to register that. I think, and art helps you register that. That's my, I think it allows you to register, though, as you move through your life. Love, making love to somebody, seeing your children or seeing your best friend. I'm always like, when I've come out of a really powerful show, I'm more in tune with, you know, what it what
yes,
it is.
Well, of course.
Yeah.
That's why you like. It should give you more, make your life richer and better and more interesting.
Yeah.